I'm going to introduce you to APLR connectivity. It's an architecture which is very similar to microservices architecture. So we are going to understand how you can create microservices using MuleSoft ESB by following this APLR architecture. And we are going to start understanding what are the problems that developers, that us, are facing in the IT industry today, and how MuleSoft and Anypoint platform are going to address them. So how we are going to benefit them with the help of that. We are going to understand how we can take the reusability to the next level. So far we have been creating projects using some programming language like Java or .NET or some other programming language. And in that, we create reusable components like Java classes, .NET classes, DLL files, and so on. And using this MuleSoft API, we are going to take this reusability to the next level. And after that, we are going to understand the advantages and the challenges also that we are going to face if you follow this architecture. Okay, whenever you change your architecture and you try to follow something new in the industry, there will be always advantages as well as challenges. So if I address something, so I need to explain you the advantages as well as the challenges, and I need to address the challenges also that we are going to face with this approach. Then how MuleSoft is providing solution for these challenges. Then after that, I'm going to introduce you to Anypoint platform, various components of Anypoint platform, so that you can understand what exactly is this platform, what kind of things you can do, and various components of it. So this agenda, so let us begin it. So we are going to start understanding what are the problems that developers are following currently, which I can explain you very easily with the help of this graph. So today developers are definitely overloaded, and you can see that in this graph. So if you see this graph here, the x-axis representing time and the y-axis representing the responsibilities on developer. And you can see orange color line. Let me just use my cursor. Yeah. So if you see this orange line, it is representing how much work a developer can do in the given amount of time. So if I am taking a developer today and I am giving him 1 month of time, so if I just do the math, he'll be having 8 hours and 22 days a month. So he can do some work. And if I take same developer after 1 year and give him same amount of time, he's going to have same working hours, he can do same work. And if I go back 10 years, do the same, he can do same work. So the work that can be done by a developer is constant throughout the time. So if you take today, 10 years ago or 10 years after, he can do exactly same work. But if you see the red lines here, so these are the responsibilities that a developer should perform nowadays. And if you see here, nowadays we are dealing with different types of clients. For example, let's say I'm working for Flipkart application. And you can access your Flipkart application, your Flipkart account, maybe 6-7 years ago, only through web application, only through web browser. But nowadays I can access same Flipkart account in my web browser, in my mobile application, and in my smartwatch, smart TV, and so on. So nowadays, if I take a Flipkart developer, he should develop and support not only mobile application, not only web application, but also mobile applications. He should also support smartwatch applications and smart TV applications, and so on. So what I'm trying to explain to you is, now developer is having more work, but he is having exactly the same amount of time. So we need to find a faster way for our developers to do much more work in the same given amount of time. So this is where Mule comes into picture, which will be clarified to you in a couple of minutes. And if I take the second line, nowadays, if I take any application that requires the integration with various other systems, maybe in your application, you want to access data which is inside Salesforce. So your application should integrate with Salesforce. To integrate with Salesforce, you have to use Salesforce API, and you need to write some client-side code according to that Salesforce API. And if I take Salesforce API, they are going to release a new version every 3 months. And if you want to use the new features, you have to upgrade your client-side code to the latest version of Salesforce API. And the third line, it represents digital competition. So if I assume myself as an employee to Flipkart, and my competition is going to be Amazon, eBay, and so on. In case if Amazon is providing a new feature like you can track your order item real time once it's being out for delivery, and if Flipkart is not providing same feature, then Flipkart is going to lose the competition in our digital market. So to stand in the competition, so as a Flipkart employee, I need to provide the same option in the Flipkart application very faster. I cannot take a whole 1 year of time or 2 years of time to provide same feature. They have to implement it very fast so that I can stand in the competition. And if you see them, these are only going to be increased exponentially. And if you see how much a developer can work, it remains constant throughout the time. So today itself, we can see a clear gap between how much a developer can work and what are the responsibilities that developer is getting. There is a clear gap. So we are not able to keep up the things. And going further, the gap will be only increased. Okay. Yeah, so these are the same points which I have explained. And this is because we are facing these issues because we are following an approach that is called a project-based approach, which is followed by many companies, which is causing all these issues. So what is this project-based approach? And this is the approach that many companies are following nowadays. So project-based approach is nothing but creating a monolithic application for the entire requirement. So if I get a requirement, nowadays companies will analyze the requirement, they create the requirement document, and they start implementing it as a single application using a single programming language like Java or some other programming language. And even though there are advantages of this approach, there are some setbacks also, which we can see here. So the major setbacks of this project-based approach is you cannot reuse your functionality properly. So what do I mean by you cannot reuse your functionality properly? So let's imagine today we are creating a web application for this requirement. So you can take a minute of time to read this requirement to understand this concept better. So I'm giving you a minute. You can read this small piece of data to understand what is the requirement. Then we'll see this approach and we'll understand what are the problems of this approach. So we have a minute. So you can read this piece of information, then I'm going to explain it. Okay, so we are going to assume that this requirement is came to us from one of our client, and we are assuming that we are implementing this requirement as a single project so that I can explain you what are the setbacks of following this project-based approach. So the requirement is quite simple. But my client is asking me to create a web application that can provide real-time data about order status and order history for sales team. So in case you are wondering what is this sales team, you can assume sales team is nothing but customer care executives. So now we can read it. So I want to create a web application that provides real-time data to track the order status and order history. This data will be used by customer care executives to help resolve customer issues. So if I am a Flipkart customer, I have purchased so-and-so product, but I'm not able to see my order, I'm not able to track it. So I'm going to call customer care team. I'm going to give them my customer ID. Then the customer care team will take my customer ID and they will fetch my customer data using this application, as well as they'll fetch my order status and the order history. So to implement this application, I need some data. As I have explained, the customer care team will ask the customer only customer ID or email ID. Based on that, they should fetch customer data. Then based on customer data, they are going to see the order status, order history, by fetching that data. So I need to fetch some data, use the data inside this application. What kind of data we need? We need order data, which includes order status, order history data, and we need customer data, and we need inventory data also. The customer care executives should have access to inventory data, just in case the customer is asking for replacement order. So the customer care executive should see the inventory is available. If available, he should do the replacement order. And we have this data in the corresponding backend systems. So we have this order data in some e-commerce system, which I have mentioned here. And you can see the inventory data is available in SAP, and the customer data is available in two systems, in SAP and Salesforce. So it is like this. So I take my customer data and I maintain 50% of customer data in SAP and 50% of customer data in Salesforce. So this is the requirement that we have got from our client. Now, if I implement a single project by following project-based approach for this requirement, the project looks like this. So you can see I have all these three data systems here, which are mentioned below. Now, the first thing that customer care executive is going to retrieve is the complete customer data. So to retrieve complete customer data, we need to have a module here, which I have mentioned as aggregated customer data module, which is going to integrate with SAP and Salesforce to fetch customer data. Then based on this, the customer care executive will retrieve either order status or order history, depending on the customer requirement. So if it is order status, the order status will communicate with customer data module. It will fetch customer data. Then based on the customer data, it will send, will fetch the order status from the e-commerce application. And the same thing happens in case of order history. If customer is asking for order history, then customer care executive will send a request to this order history module from this WebApp API. And this order history will communicate with aggregated customer data module to fetch customer data. Then based on that customer data, the order history module will fetch order history from this e-commerce application. So this is how the single project looks like. And this project seems good and it works fine. We can deliver this project on time within budget. Everything is fine, but we need to face the problems once we get into this situation. So currently we are here, and this project will work very fine. We'll have the expected performance. We can do it on time within the budget, but the real problems will only start if the situation becomes like this. Oh, what is it here? So currently the client expectation is only a web application. So they want to access this functionality only through web application. And after a couple of months, they might expect the same functionality to be accessed by mobile application, just in case. So currently client is expecting to support only web browsers. Only through a web browser, this application can be accessed. And after, client might want us to support mobile application also. So mobile application is a different type of client. Web browser is a different type of client. And they'll be definitely having different set of requirements. Maybe this web application might be expecting the response data in XML format, and this mobile application might be expecting the response data in JSON format. Or maybe the web application might be expecting some kind of view like time leaf, velocity, or JSP pages. And where in mobile application, the mobile itself is having its own UI. So it is just expecting data. And because the screen sizes are different, so in web application, I can display all data in one screen, but in the mobile application, I want to display only the essential data initially, along with more details link. When that more details link clicked in this mobile application, the further data will be displayed. So the different client is having different requirements. That's what I'm trying to explain. So you cannot ask this mobile client to consume data from WebApp API, because this WebApp API is designed to support web browsers. And for this mobile client, we need to create mobile API. And here also, I want to have similar features. So now one thing to make it possible, one thing I can do is, I can just take this existing project and I can modify this existing project to support this mobile API. That is one thing I can do, but that is too risky, isn't it? So modifying the functionality inside an existing project, which is working very fine, is too risky. Or I can follow the second approach. The second approach, just create a new project altogether to support mobile API. And inside this new project, just, you know, reuse your existing modules. Just copy them, paste them into your new project. So you can reuse the code. But I have already mentioned here, the opportunity of reusing the functionality is very much limited. So if I can just take these modules, copy paste them into this new application, I can reuse it, but I'm mentioning the opportunity of reusing is very much limited. Let me tell you why. So let us say this old project was created using Java programming language. And the time of creating this new project, you might not have, the company might not have Java resources. They might have only .NET developers. So they have decided to create this new application using .NET. Then I cannot reuse the code. I cannot use the jar files or Java classes inside a .NET project. So I cannot reuse it. So currently, with a single project-based approach, we are limited to reuse the functionality only at functionality level, only at code level. So you can take your code, you can create some jar files out of it, then add those jar files to a new project to reuse the functionality. Then modify something on top of these existing jar files to achieve new requirements, to satisfy new requirements. So this is the approach that we need to follow if you are following this project-based approach. Whenever you want to support a new client, so you need to create a new project from scratch, or you have to take the risk of modifying the code inside a working project, which is too risky. So these two approaches are not so good. And this is where Mule is suggesting a new approach called API-led architecture or API-led connectivity. Now, according to this API-led connectivity, so these are the problems actually I have explained here. Now, according to this API-led connectivity, you should not create one single big project for the entire requirement. So instead, take your requirement, then split the requirement into multiple small requirements. Then create a separate API for each and every small requirement. And each and every small API will be a separate project. So each API is its own project. Now, if I take my big requirement, split the requirement into like maybe 20 smaller requirements, then I have to create 20 separate APIs for each and every small requirement. Now, each and every small API will be doing a single purpose, and it is small enough that a single developer can work on it from scratch to the end. So you don't need to maintain a big developer team. And if you have a big developer team, we'll be spending most of our time in meetings and discussing the code, commits, and the build failures. But when there is a single developer working on the small API from scratch till the end, so he'll take all the responsibilities. So there is no need to communicate and synchronize with other developers, because a single developer will make sure the small API is small enough so that a single developer can work on it. But the question is, on basis of what we have to split the requirement? So it's quite simple. There are a couple of steps that MuleSoft is suggesting, based on what you can split your big requirement into smaller requirement. Okay. So let me explain you what are the steps we can consider while splitting our big requirement into small requirements. So you can split your requirement based on what kind of backend systems you are working on. And if I see this requirement, this is expecting to communicate with three backend data systems. One is SAP, Salesforce, and the other one is some e-commerce application. So this e-commerce application might be a backend SOAP service or RESTful web service. So these are the backend data systems that my application is going to work on. So you have to split them according to what systems you are using. So I'm using three systems, SAP system, all these are data systems, Salesforce, and e-commerce application. So instead of saying e-commerce application, let's assume it as a SOAP service, some legacy SOAP service, or maybe you can assume it as a RESTful web service. So these are the three data systems on which I want to build my small APIs. So this is your starting point. For each and every data system, you'll be creating an API. So for on top of SAP, you'll be creating an API. So what is the purpose of that API? So this API will integrate with SAP It connects with SAP. It will fetch data from SAP. It will expose the raw data. So it is just going to connect with backend system. It will just fetch data from it, expose the data as it is. It is not going to validate the data. It's not going to filter the data. It's not going to do any business process. It is not going to do any business functionality. It will just integrate with the backend system and fetch data from it, expose the data as an API. Oh, but what API? We have two types of APIs, right? SOAP and REST. So it will expose the data according to your requirement. So you can design this API to expose the data either as SOAP API or REST API. But which one is best? If I just consider the ease of consuming, ease of exposing, I can suggest REST APIs. If I create a REST API, first of all, that is easy for a developer to create and easy for a client to consume. But there is no such limitation. You can go with SOAP APIs also. MuleSoft supports SOAP APIs also. But the thing is, if it is a REST API, it is going to be easy for you to develop it as well as for your client to consume it. So we are going to create a RESTful API or simply REST API on top of SAP system. And what is the function? What should be the functionality inside it? We have to integrate with it, then fetch data from it, expose the raw data. Okay, so do not do any fancy things, like do not do any validations. Okay, do not do any business functionality, no orchestration, nothing. Just connect it, fetch it, expose the raw data as it is. Then my second system is Salesforce. So I'm going to create another REST API on top of Salesforce, which will do same thing. So this REST API will integrate with Salesforce. It will take it as Salesforce REST API, SAP REST API. So it will integrate with Salesforce, fetch data from it, expose the raw data as an API. And we already understood that REST APIs are good in terms of creating them as well as consuming them. Then for this backend e-commerce application, which we have assumed as a SOAP service, on top of it, let's take e-commerce REST API. So this is going to integrate with this e-commerce application, which we have assumed as SOAP, and to consume the data from it, re-expose the data as it is. Okay. So that is your first step actually. Okay. This is the first step. So you are going to create multiple smaller APIs for each and every backend system that you want to work on. And all these are going to be REST APIs. And we call these APIs as system APIs, as they are simply connecting to backend systems, exposing data. Now, from the system APIs, we are getting only raw data, but no client is expecting the raw data as it is. So your client is expecting the usable data. So your client, if the client is a web application, so in this web application, I want to see the customer data with corresponding order status or order history. So let's say from this browser, from this web browser, I have clicked on order status link. And this order status link should display me the customer details, like, okay, the customer name is so-and-so, some maybe Suresh, and customer contact information, some email ID. Below to that, the order status of his products. So first of all, to display this customer data and the order data, I have this customer data in these two APIs, in SAP Customers API, in Salesforce Customer API. So I need another API which will connect to these two APIs, collect the data from it, aggregate it, give me a single unit of customer data. So for this, I'm going to create another API. So we have to create the next level APIs depending on what business functionality you want to do on this raw data. See, first of all, we have decided to create the system APIs. Now they are exposing only raw data. Now to convert this raw data to usable data, I have to process it. So to process it, you have to create a couple of APIs. And my processing is like this. So my first processing is, I want all the customer data in a single schema as a single unit. So this is my first processing. For this, we are going to create one API. So one API that will connect with existing two customer APIs corresponding to SAP and Salesforce. And this SAP might be exposing data in maybe some XML format, and this Salesforce customer API might be exposing data in JSON format. So So we have to read these two data formats in this customer's API, convert them to a canonical format, then aggregate the two data sets into one data set, then you can input it to some other API. So this is going to be one of my process API. And inside this API, I need to add some business process. And here the business process is, we have to orchestrate between customer's SAP API, customer Salesforce API, then convert them to a canonical data format, then aggregate them, then re-explore it. So this is one business process. And now you have to think about other business processes that you are expecting in your application or in your big requirement. So in my big requirement, the other process functionality that I'm expecting is orchestrating between the customer data and order status, then orchestrating between customer data and order history. So for doing those two business functionalities, I'm creating two more APIs. So order status API, order history API. This order status API will first communicate with our customer's API, get the customer data. Based on the customer data, it will communicate with orders API to fetch order status. And here, same thing. It will communicate with customer's API to get customer data. Based on that, it will communicate with orders API to get order history. Then it will combine that customer data and order status, here customer data and order history, will re-expose it. So inside this APIs, I'm clearly doing some business functionality like orchestrating between multiple other APIs and transforming the data to a canonical format so that I can aggregate them, then putting the data as a single unit, then exposing it. So that is your next step. So you need to understand what business process you want. You have to segregate the business process requirement into separate groups. And for each and every group, there should be an API. And in this APIs, the responsibility is doing business process. So we call these set of APIs as process APIs. And ultimately from this process API, I am getting process data. So these process APIs are exposing process data, processed data. And finally, this processed data will be fed into another API called Experience API, which will do the final data manipulations according to your client requirement. So let's say I have created this process API to generate JSON data, and finally your client is expecting some kind of user interface through JSP pages, Timelief or Velocity. So reading the processed data, then putting them into a view technology will be taken care by Experience API. Or let's say this web browser client is expecting XML, but this process APIs are only generating JSON. So taking this JSON, converting this JSON into the required XML format will be taken care by this Experience API. Now, if you follow this approach, what is the advantage? First of all, I'm having multiple smaller APIs, and each and every API is doing one purpose. Now, tomorrow, if I want to support mobile client, okay, all I need to do is, I need to create one mobile experience API. Then this mobile experience API will be consuming the process data from the existing process APIs. Now, it doesn't matter which programming language this mobile experience API is using. So let us say I have developed all these APIs using Java, and ultimately all these are REST APIs. And tomorrow I got the requirement to support mobile applications. Further, I'm creating this mobile API using .NET. Now, can you tell me, can I consume a Java-based REST API from .NET-based REST API? Any answers? So you can use the chat box to type the answers. So can I consume a REST API that is developed based on Java from a .NET application? So we got an answer, yes. And any other people having any other doubts regarding this? No, right? So we can consume a REST API that is developed using Java from a REST API or SOAP API, which is developed using .NET. Because ultimately, you are not using the programming languages to communicate now, okay? So you are just creating all these things as individual APIs. Now you can consume whichever API you want. So let's say this mobile client is not happy with this process data. Then you can take this system data, which is the raw data, you can feed that system data just give me a second. So you can take this system data, the raw data that is exposed to the system APIs, you can directly feed it here, then process that according to your requirement. Okay, or else you can create a new process API, then this is for mobile, then feed the data from system APIs and process the data in a way that it can be used by mobile clients. Then feed this processed data from this process API into this experience API. So still you are reusing this system layer, okay, without having to recreate them, without having to modify them. So this is the advantage of API-led connectivity. But why the name API-led connectivity? If you see this picture, it's very clear. Now you have so many smaller APIs which are connected together to achieve your final requirements. So the connectivity that is led by multiple APIs to achieve our requirements. Hence, the name is API-led connectivity. Now, according to this API-led connectivity, what we are supposed to do? So take your big requirement, split the requirement into multiple smaller requirements, then create a small API for each and every small requirement. And make sure these small APIs are easily creatable as well as easily consumable. So that is the reason to make the to create the APIs easily, to consume it easily. So we are going to create all these APIs as REST APIs instead of creating them as SOAP APIs. Now, if you just see here, so what exactly we are doing here? We are just taking the reusability to the next level. Instead of reusing a Java jar file or a .NET DLL file, which is code level reusability, now we are reusing as an APIs. In code level reusability, if it is a Java jar file, you can reuse it only in some other Java application. You cannot reuse a Java based jar file in a .NET application and vice versa. But here, you can reuse the APIs independently, individually, as well as without having to depending on the programming language. So we are just taking the reusability to the next level. Not only that, because now we have many smaller APIs, you can apply different security mechanism for each and every API. So maybe I can secure this customer's SAP API with the help of basic authentication, and I want this address API secured with a better authentication mechanism like open authentication, and I want 1,000 requests per minute for this order API and only 500 requests per minute for this customer API. So you can govern your application very easily, independently, as well as individually, because now we have all these APIs as separate applications. Now, if you just take this monolithic project, so inside this monolithic project, if you want to apply different security mechanism for different modules, yeah, that is possible, but that's going to take us a lot of time and a lot of complexities involved compared with this approach, where you have all separate APIs, you can independently maintain security and some other enterprise services like rate limit and so on for them. So this is the picture that we are trying to achieve. The picture says, according to API-led architecture, we have to create reusable assets. And here, reusable asset is nothing but API. So we have to create reusable APIs. And then these reusable APIs should be consumed by other APIs. So what do I mean? For example, if I am creating system APIs, they should be consumed by process APIs. So whoever is developing process APIs should be able to see the system APIs, discover the system APIs easily, and integrate with them, consume them. And whoever is working on the experience APIs, they should discover the process APIs easily, and they should consume them easily. And here, these different types of APIs, system APIs, process APIs, and experience APIs, will be developed by different teams of our company. So in our company, we'll be having teams like central IT team, line of business IT team, and developers IT team. There will be three teams. So the central IT team will take the responsibility of creating system APIs in general, and the LOB IT, which is line of business IT team, will create process APIs, and the developers IT team will be working on experience APIs. So according to the picture, whenever central IT produces reusable APIs, they should put them into a discoverable unit so that they can be discovered and consumed by LOBIT team to create PROS APIs. And when LOBIT team produces reusable PROS APIs, they should put them into same discoverable unit so that they can be discovered and consumed by the LOBIT team. So it's quite simple to understand. Whenever any developer team creates system APIs, they should put them into a discoverable unit so that the process APIs team can discover them and can consume them. Then we got process APIs. Then this LOBIT team should put them into same discoverable unit so that developers IT team who are working on experience APIs will be able to find these process APIs and consume them. So we need to have a centralized repository where each and every team can create the APIs and publish them into that repository so that other teams can discover the APIs and construct their functionality on top of these APIs. So the bottom line says, a team develops a reusable API, then the team should put that API into a discoverable repository so that other teams can find it and they can build their APIs on top of these existing APIs. And whenever there is a new requirement, if a new requirement comes in, then instead of creating this new requirement from scratch, I just need to go to this discoverable repository, find existing APIs which I can use, then build my new requirement on top of these existing APIs. So it's like building blocks. It's like Lego bricks. So if I am having a bunch of Lego bricks with me, then I can just take the same Lego bricks and arrange them in different orders to achieve different structures. Same thing here. Now each and every small API is like a Lego brick. You can use them in n number of different ways, in n number of different combinations to achieve new requirement. Now whenever you're on the strategic cloud, so you will think of existing APIs and some APIs which you are going to use and build your new requirement on top of these APIs. So you can do the building of new requirement faster. And this is what we are trying to achieve, because that is what the problem that we are facing today. So the developer is having same time, in the same amount of time, the developer should do more. So to do more work in the same given amount of time, developer should not do everything from scratch. A developer should reuse existing components, existing APIs, and build the new functionality on top of it. So this is the problem that we are facing, and this is how Mule is addressing that problem. Okay. Now the advantages, we have smaller APIs. One developer, we will make sure the API is small enough that one developer or maybe max to max two developers can do the API from scratch to the end, so that we'll be having less time, we'll be spending less time in meetings, more time in doing the actual work. And once I create an API, it's going to be a reusable component. So whenever there is a new requirement where I want similar functionality, I can just call this API, get the data and use the data instead of creating from scratch. Then we have small APIs so that you can govern them easily. You can apply different security mechanisms, different rate limits, and different enterprise services individually, independently. So these are the advantages. And moreover, you can do your work faster, as you are saving a lot of time, okay, in the name of meetings and all. Okay, you will be avoiding all these meetings to discuss, to synchronize the developers. So we'll be saving a lot of time. And once you create API, you'll be reusing it so that whenever there is a new feature, you'll be implementing on top of existing APIs. So this way, you're creating reusable building blocks. You'll just reuse them to create new features. So this way, you're going to save a lot of time. So these are the main concept, main advantage of this approach. Now I want you to think and try to find some challenges of this approach. So as you see our agenda here, okay, there are not only advantages of multiple small APIs, there are some challenges as well when you are following this. So can you try and find out some challenges? if I follow this architecture, API-led architecture, which is nothing but creating multiple smaller services. Each and every API is a small service. So small service, or I can use the jargon, technical jargon, microservice. So this API-led architecture is nothing but creating multiple microservices, then connect them with each other. So this is nothing but microservice architecture, right? So with this microservice architecture, where you have multiple smaller services, smaller APIs, right? Do you see any challenges? Anyone? At least a couple of challenges, maybe. So think of it across services will be, yes, so there are delays, yes, of course. Now, you know, from the mobile client to reach this SAP, so I need one HTTP call, then another call, another call, another, like I can just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 API calls. Okay, earlier it was a direct call, so performance issues. But what I can say is nowadays with larger bandwidths, okay, so that's not going to be a big issue. Okay, yeah. So you can just purchase a larger bandwidth and you can have slightly, you know, bigger SLA for the response. Okay, so with that, this problem can be taken care. Yeah, I got one more thing. Lot of orchestration to take care of. Exactly, lot of orchestration to take care of. Anything else? So I need an easy way to take care of this orchestration. Anything else? Cascading failures. If my SAP customer's API does not respond, then this customer's API will not be responding. Then this order status API, order history API will go not responding. And then this mobile API and experience API also will not be responding. So cascading failures. So how we can take care of this cascading failures? So nowadays we see, I'm getting this cascading failure because this SAP customer's API is down. So it went down, so which is causing this cascading failures. So to take care of this issue, okay, I don't have to use Mule to take care of this issue. I can just create a cluster, deploy this API into the cluster, so that if one or two nodes of the cluster are down, the remaining nodes will take the load. So you might get the response a little slow, but still, you get the response, you don't get cascading failures. So there is another issue, and the corresponding solution is you deploy the application to your cluster. So a lot of API calls, that is one challenge. Okay, so the delay, the response will be delayed. That is one challenge. And I'm saying that the solution is with bigger bandwidths, that's not going to be a problem anymore nowadays. And the second problem, lot of orchestration to take care of. So this is where Mule comes into picture and it will help us, which we'll understand in two, three minutes. And the third issue, cascading failures, the solution is we need to deploy each and every API into a cluster so that if one or two nodes or a couple of nodes of cluster is getting down, the remaining nodes of the cluster will take the load. The response might be slow, but it will not cause cascading failures. The major issue that I see here is, yeah, one is orchestration, of course, okay. The other major issues that I see is, now I don't have a single application. I have so many smaller APIs and each and every API is nothing but its own RESTful web service application. So each API is a RESTful web service application, isn't it? Now I have to design, develop, test, deploy, and manage this many number of APIs. And if you see here, you can see network of applications, right? So this is also known as application network in many companies. So this structure is creating an application network, network of applications. And in general, in my experience, I have seen application networks with 650 plus APIs. So if I'm taking a known example, so you would have known Netflix company, so which is video streaming company. So a couple of years ago, they changed their monolithic application to microservice based application and they ended up with 650 APIs, 650 plus APIs. So in their application network, there are 650 plus APIs. Now let's say in your company, your project doesn't have that many number of APIs, still it will be having like 100 plus APIs. more or less. Now you need to design, test the design, develop, test the develop, test the developed functionality, then deploy, secure, manage, troubleshoot, version, this many number of APIs. That is the biggest challenge that we are going to face as developers. And this is where Mule comes into picture. Okay, so I have mentioned the API development lifecycle. So for each and every API that is mentioned, that is part of your application network, for each and every API of your application network, you have to perform all these steps. So you can see the steps. The first step is design. So you have to design your API. So what is this designing API? Let me just take it. So let's say I'm taking SOAP API. In case of SOAP API, to describe your SOAP API to the client, do I need to create any contract file? If yes, what that should be? Any answers? If it is a SOAP API, so what should be the, yes, so WSDL file. So the contract file is WSDL file. Now we have decided not to use SOAP APIs because they're complex. We have decided to do all these APIs as RESTful APIs. In case of RESTful APIs, officially there is no specification available like WSDL, but unofficially we have RAML. RAML stands for RESTful API Modeling Language. We have Swagger. And we have hand coding, we have API blueprint, and so on. So all these are the specifications using which I can describe a RESTful web service. And first you have to create this contract file, this API specification. Okay, so this is called as contract, and it is officially known as API specification in Mule. So you have to design this API specification, which is nothing but creating a RAML file. Let me just take it into Paint so that I can explain you properly. So you have to repeat all these steps. So first of all, you have to design, which is nothing but creating a RAML. And once you create the RAML, there is no guarantee whether this RAML is properly created or are there any design mistakes or any other mistakes until unless you are testing it. But this RAML file, it is nothing but a contract file. It's like a text file. So where you have to describe everything about your API, saying that, okay, my API has this many number of operations. It follows this schema. It follows this query parameters and so on. So it's like a text file. I cannot test a text file until unless I'm creating a mocking service, until unless I create a mock application for this RAML. So I have to mock it. Then mock is nothing but a dummy application that we are going to create based on this RAML. Then we can deploy the dummy application. We can start sending requests to the dummy application, and that mock, let's not use the word dummy, let me call it as mock. Then that mock application will provide us mock responses according to this RAML specification. Then I see this response coming from this mock application. The response is proper, then I can assume my RAML design is proper. So I have to mock it and test it. Then once you are happy, once you are satisfied with your API, then you have to share this RAML API with your clients so that they can also test it just like you tested, and they can send you feedback. What if they are giving you negative feedback? They are saying, okay, in my perspective, your RAML is not so good. So let's say I'm the client, I'm saying, okay, so you have given me some RAML, in my perspective, that is not so good. So you need to have, you need to change this, this, and this. So if you get such a negative feedback from your client, then you need to just go back, redesign, again mark and test, again share it with client. You might again get negative feedback, so you need to again just do it one more time, and so on until you get positive feedback from your client. And once you get positive feedback from your client, you can proceed to next step. Okay, so what is the next step? And first of all, what will be the output of this first cycle? The output of first cycle is a valid API specification, which is RAML file. Okay, then after completion of that, the next thing that you want to do is these steps, which is not, which contains implementing API and then testing that functionality. What is this implementation of API? Implementing API is nothing but creating that RESTful web service. Okay, creating this RESTful web service and writing functionality inside it. Then you need to test that functionality. Okay, and if I'm creating this RESTful web service using Mule, I can test it using MUnit. And once my test results are positive, okay, if they are negative, you have to re-implement it. And if the test results are positive, then you can go to next phase. The next phase is deploying and maintaining it. So here you have to version your API, secure, deploy, monitor, and all the stuff. So the biggest problem is this. These are API development lifecycle steps. And this API development lifecycle contains three phases: design phase, implementation phase, deploy and manage phase. Again, each phase contains multiple steps inside them. So you have to perform all these steps for all of your APIs, which is going to take us a lot of time. And this is where Mule and Anypoint platform comes into picture. So in Anypoint platform, okay, as the name says, it's a platform actually. You'll come to know what is this platform in a couple of minutes, just 2 or 3 minutes. So in Anypoint platform, as the name says, it's a platform, right? So we have a tool called API Designer, using which I can design n number of APIs seamlessly. Then after that, in the same Anypoint platform, we have another tool called Marking Service, using which I can just click on a button to mark my app, to mark this RAML file. And it will also provide me something called a console, using which I can test it very easily as well as faster. And within this Anypoint platform, we have something called Exchange. Okay. So this Exchange is nothing but a repository where you can share your APIs with your clients. So within this Exchange, your clients can test it and they can send you feedback. If it is negative feedback, you can immediately go back to this design center, redesign, and the marking service will be automatically enabled once you enable it and test it. I can share it. Then ultimately you'll get positive feedback from your client. Then you have to implement your API. So in implementation, I can implement this RESTful web service using Java or .NET. So it's okay. So Mule doesn't have any issues with that. But if you have decided to implement this RESTful web service application using Java or .NET or any other programming language, you will end up in writing thousands of lines of code. But instead, I can implement this API using MuleSoft ESB, which is this is also part of Anypoint platform, where I have so many predefined components. So I can just drag and drop them to implement the functionality. So let's say I want to implement the functionality by integrating with SAP. I need to drag and drop SAP connector, and SAP might be giving you the data in IDOC format, but ultimately you want JSON data. So you can drag and drop this IDOC to JSON transformer, which will transform the data from IDOC to JSON, or you can drag and drop the corresponding transformer for doing the transformation. So we have all these predefined components in MuleSoft ESB. And if you ask me how many predefined components are there, let me quickly show you the rough number. So in MuleSoft ESB, we have approximately 160 predefined connectors, using which you can connect with Salesforce, SAP, Soap Service, REST Service, you can integrate with Twitter, Facebook, you can integrate with MQ servers, SMTP, FTP, okay, and any other system that you can think of. And we have different types of routers, filters, validators, transformers. So all you are going to do is you are just going to create a Mule application using this Mule ESB and drag and drop these predefined components to create your functionality. So which is going to take very less amount of time. So in my experience, so I tried doing a functionality called integrating with Facebook, and Google for open authentication. So it took me almost 1.5 months because I was doing it using Java and some Java-based frameworks. Then I have done the same thing using MuleSoft TSB. It hardly took me 1 day and even less. Because with Mule, all I needed to do was drag and drop Facebook connector, then configure my Facebook authentication, then drag and drop Google connector, configure my Google parameters, like the username, URL, password, and so on. Then I'm done with it. Okay. Then you can test it using MUnit, which I have already mentioned here. Then to version it, there is another tool called API Manager. Then to secure it, you can use same tool, API Manager. To deploy it, we have another tool called Runtime Manager. To monitor, we have another tool called API Monitoring. Then to analyze, we have another tool called same tool, that is API Manager. Troubleshoot, you can use Runtime Manager. And the scaled application up or down, you can use Runtime Manager. So what I'm going to explain to you is, you can do this complete API development lifecycle with a fraction of time that is actually required if you are not using AnyPoint platform. So if you are not using AnyPoint platform, if this is taking you like 1 month of time to create one API from scratch to end, with AnyPoint platform, you are going to do it like maybe in 1 day or little bit less or more. So there are so many tools like this, and all these tools together is called as AnyPoint platform. And we have this AnyPoint platform as online version as well as offline version. So you can access this platform through online account as well as you can download it, you can use it. Okay, so I think we have enough conceptual knowledge. Now let us explore this AnyPoint platform. Okay, so let us see how you can do the things. So let me quickly log into AnyPoint platform. And I'm using online version here, which is the trial version for 30 days. And if you want the offline version, you have to have the license, purchase the license, then download it, install it into your infrastructure. Okay, so this is my online AnyPoint platform. You can see the title. And here we have this design center, inside which we have this API designer. And inside of this API designer, we have marketing service and all. Now you can see Exchange here, API Manager, Runtime Manager. So let us quickly see an example regarding that. So let me start designing it using API Design Center. So in Design Center, we have this API designer. Yeah, so I have already a couple of APIs here. Now we can create a new API like this. So once I select this create and API specification, it will take me to API designer. You can see the option API designer. So let me take it as something like hotels API, or let's take it as customers API. Okay, this customer's API, but I don't have the infrastructure of SAP and Salesforce. So we are going to build this customer's API on top of database. Okay, let us quickly do that. So create API specification. Let me take the name as customer's API and start designing it. And Mule by default using RAML as the API specification. So we need to know the RAML. So because we have very limited amount of time here, so I'm not explaining you, I'm not teaching you what is RAML. So I'm just gonna show you how you can do the things in RAML, okay? And once we get the complete 5-day course, then in that I can explain you in detail what is this RAML and all. So after all, this is REST API, so I need to have resources configured. So customers is my resource, and I should be able to get the customers as well as post the customers. While getting the customers, I want to get the customers using a query parameter called customer name. I am expecting this parameter as an optional parameter required equal to false. So if my client is sending get method to slash customers and he is not providing customer name, then I'm going to give all the customers to him. Okay, so let's say this is used by the administrators. So they might want to get the customer based on customer name, or to make it more meaningful, let's take it as email. So whenever a customer care person calls in, whenever you call a customer care executive, you need to tell the customer care executive your email ID. Based on your email ID, he is going to fetch your information. So what if you don't know your email ID? Okay, no need to worry. So I'm going to add a sub resource, customer ID. So if you don't know, maybe if you don't want to disclose your email ID, but some other reason, okay, you are giving the customer care executive your customer ID. So based on this customer ID also, the customer care executive can fetch your information, but he has to send request to slash customers, slash customer ID, get method. Okay. Then I need to specify some responses information corresponding to this get method. So I can just add responses. Under that, I can specify the responses for a particular status code with response body, maybe in JSON format. Okay, and I can also describe some example, and I can also specify a data type. Okay, according to which the customer care executive who is going to use this API will get the data. Now I need to specify some example. So instead of, see, I can write the example directly here, or I can create this example in a separate file, include it. So there is a better option. So if I include a separate file, I can reuse it also in a couple of places. So let me include it. I'm just creating a file called customers example.yaml. I don't have such a file with me, and I'm going to create a new file inside the folder that is specified there. And this is going to be example file. And this is the name I have used there. And here I'm going to do the example. Okay, so instead of just typing it, let me quickly copy paste it. Okay, just give me a second. I'm just trying to copy paste it. So let me take customer_ID, customer name, email. I want another customer, because it is customers, so there has to be at least couple of them to make my client understand he is going to get array of customers. Okay. So there are some errors. Just give me a second. Okay, let me quickly create a data type. Let me include it. Include data type slash customer.raml. So these are called RAML fragments. So RAML fragments are small sections of the main RAML where I can have a specific type of data, like example or data type. Data type is nothing but schema, okay, and so on. Let me quickly create another folder, data types, and let me create a new data type here. Okay. And for this also, let me just copy paste the data. So the data type is nothing but schema, so I'm just giving all the details. In this example, I have defined custom ID, name, and email. So let me specify the same thing here. So this is my data type. And if I go back to the main RAML, so I'm getting error here. So let us see what is the error. So it is complaining about you have to include your example using examples keyword instead of using example keyword. But the real thing is, the supposed thing that we need to use is example. There is a small bug, you know, going around here. So it is, by mistake, it is asking us to use examples in the place of example. So this bug is already identified and it will be resolved. Okay. Yeah. So now I'm just following the bug, and according to it, it should be examples. I'm giving it. But according to RAML specification, it has to be just example, as I'm giving it just one example here, okay? But let's follow the bug, and to satisfy it, I'm just giving the examples keyword, which is not the correct thing. So finally, I'm gonna comment it, okay? So in the same way, I'm gonna give the responses for get method slash customers ID, okay? With the response body, JSON. With an example and data type. So I'm going to include the same data type. Okay, but I cannot use same example. Let us see why. So just click on this example. It contains array of customers, so I cannot use that here. So I'm just going to create one more example quickly. Let me take it as customer example dot RAML. You can see the difference. This is customer's example and this is customer example. Okay, so let me just copy one customer here. And still it is array, as I'm using hyphen. So hyphen represents array in RAML. Now it is a single object. Now let me include that here. Customer example dot RAML. Yeah, here also same complaint. So I need to use examples according to the bug. And now you can see, I don't see any errors here, but it is complaining about one other error. And this is coming from this line. Okay, so it says it should be object here. Okay. What exactly it is saying? Okay, this error is a little difficult to understand. But with some experience, we can understand. Okay, what it is saying is, the error says, in line number 3 at column number 1 in examples/customers-example.raml, it should be object, it should be a single object. So the file is customers-example.raml, which is customers-example.raml, and line number 3 I am using hyphen, which defines array of customers, but it is complaining it should be a single object. That is because my data type is representing a single object. So if you see here, this data type, it is representing a single customer object, but the example represents array of customers. So this is a mismatch. Now, can you tell me which file is correct? Is the array example file is correct, or the data type is correct according to this, according to slash customers get method? And assume that this email query parameter is not given. So whenever someone invokes slash customers get, so what you will get? Will you get, will that client get array of customers, multiple of them, or a single customer? So I got a question from Vikash. He's asking about, does it support JSON schema? So actually this data type is RAML schema, which is compatible with JSON schema, XML schema, CSV. So instead of you individually maintain all the schemas, you can use RAML data type, which is the unified schema for JSON, XML, and CSV, or any other data format that is in the format of key value pairs. Okay, so that is the answer to your question, Vikas. And my question here is, what my customer get if, or what my client gets if the client is invoking slash customers get method? Will he get array of customers or single? Yes, I got an answer from aggregation. So he is saying yes, we get array of customers. So the example file is correct. This data type is not correct. The data type is defining a single object. So I have to convert this data type to array object. Okay, so these are, you can do it. As the data type is defining a single object, I don't want to go and modify this single object to array. I can do that, but I don't want to do that. Why? Because if I change it to array, then here I will get error. So I want to take this data type, which is defining single object, and I want to convert it to array dynamically only wherever I want. So here I want to convert it to array, but here I don't want to convert it to array. So for doing that, you can take this data type. With this data type, you can define custom types in RAML. So I'm taking it as customer type along with this file. Now here I can use just customer, which is defining one object. And here I can use customer array, where I want array of customers. So you can take your data type, define it as a custom type. Then you can decide whether you want array of it or a single object. Okay, like this. So never ever define array within this data type file. Use always object, because you know, once you create object, then you can define a custom type, use it as single object like this or array object like this. Okay, now coming to the post method. So in case of post method, see, the client will be sending me a new customer. I'm going to add the new customer to the database. Okay, so for this I have to specify the request body as well as response body. See, it supports not only JSON but also XML. Okay, so now you can decide. I'm gonna go with JSON, but in your application you can go with XML if it is required. And here also I'm specifying examples, but actually I have to specify example as it is a post method. I want to receive one customer by one customer in the post body, so I'm giving the example and data type pointing to a single customer. So this is my request body. Then I am using responses status code 201. Then I can specify the response body in whichever the format I want. I can specify JSON format, XML format. You can also specify CSV, okay, or any other format. Okay, let's specify JSON. And here also I want to give an example. Okay, I'm saying, okay, client, so you will get a message in your response saying that customer added. So this is also an example, but it is very simple example. So I'm not creating a separate file for it. As it is very simple example, I'm not defining data type also for it. So I can just go with example. So nothing is mandatory in RAML. You don't have to add the example and data type mandatory. Okay. And if you observe this time, it's not forcing me to use examples. Okay. So the bug is only there when you are including external files. The bug that is not appearing when you are writing the example inline. Okay. Now, as I'm creating this RAML, immediately right side section, I can see something called API console, where I can see my RAML file in a graphical format. So using this console, I can test this API. But to test it, we need a marking service, right? So to test it, I have already got this console here. Now all I need is a marking service. And I told you that there is a tool called marking service in AnyPoint platform. It is just a button. You just need to enable the button, which will create the marking service automatically for your API. And you can see that marking service toggle button right here. If I just flip it, now it reads RAML, it creates a mock application, will deploy the mock application to one of the MuleSoft cloud server, and that mocking URL can be seen here. Now you can just click on this get button, try it. You can add the query parameters if they are required, but these are optional actually. I can just leave it, send it, and you get the response from your mock service. So any cases, how this mock service giving us response? How it is able to give this response? So after this mock service, I didn't do anything here, okay? How this is giving me the status code and response? Any guesses? It is giving all these from the RAML examples, exactly. So here we have defined examples. So from this it is giving. Now you can see this example and you can understand whether you have configured a proper file or not. And you can see this query parameters to understand whether required query parameters are configured or not, okay? So you can just verify your RAML file graphically with the help of the console and this marking service. And once you are done with it, the next step, I want to share this with my client so that they can review it. And currently I'm working on this system API, customer's system API. And any guesses, who is going to be client for this API according to this picture? So client is nothing but another API which consumes this API. So in this picture, which API is consuming this customer's system API? Yes, customer's cross API. So the customer's cross API will be the client. So this API would be developed by some other team in your organization. So with that team, I want to share my customer's API. So I want to share this customer system API with the team that is going to work on this customer's cross API, right? So I want to share with them and they are also part of my organization. So this is where this exchange comes into picture. Okay. My client is the same organization, another team from the same organization. So I want to share this marking service and the RAML file with that team so I can use exchange. And here itself, we can see a small button using which you can publish it to exchange. So click on this button. It will ask you your API details and you can publish. Okay, I'm not focusing on what are all those parameters it is asking for, because that we'll discuss in detail in our full length training. Now it is published to Exchange. If I go to the Exchange, not only me, the other team also part of same organization. They are also using same AnyPoint platform account, just like me. So they can go to Exchange and here they can find our customer's API. They can download this API to test it, or they can use this console along if I click on any method on the console, they can see the marking service. They can also test it just like I have tested. Now I'm not the owner of this customer's API anymore. So now I'm assuming myself as the developer of customer process API. So as a customer process API developer, I need to test this customer's API, whether it is satisfying my requirements or not. So that's what I'm testing now. Yeah, it seems good to me. Now I'm going to tell them at the bottom, I'm going to tell them with 5 stars that good one, Go ahead. Now I am the client, so I am giving them positive feedback. If something is wrong, I am going to give them negative feedback with one star and some message description. I am going to publish it. But it seems this API is good, so I am giving them positive feedback. So if the developer is getting negative feedback, he is going to follow this, redesign, market, again share it. But you know, very first time itself, now the API got positive feedback, so we have to go and implement it. So while implementing this API, I might want to do some validations, like let's say this email type is a string. Minimum length 5 characters, maximum length like 50 characters, and I can even give the regular expression pattern that will match email. Okay, so but again I just don't want to complicate it. I'm just adding some basic validation rule saying that if, see, first of all it is optional, but if my client has decided to use the email, then it has to be a string object. It's not like email code 1234, that will not be accepted. And the minimum length is 5 characters, maximum 50 characters. So like that, I'm adding the validation rules. And in case of post method, so my client should give me input data according to this data type. Okay, so all these are my validation rules. And I might want to handle the exceptions when something goes wrong. And I might want to listen for HTTP requests for slash customers and slash customer slash ID. Okay, get method, post method. So these are the common things that I want to do in my web service application when I implement it. So in this implementation, first of all, I have to listen for HTTP requests. Okay, for slash customers, get method, post method, and the slash customer slash ID, get method. Then I want to do the validations according to the YAML file. I want to handle the exceptions according to the YAML file, and I want to do the required routing to the corresponding resources and methods, which is slash customers get method, post method, slash customers slash I, slash customers ID, get method. So these are the basic things that I'm expecting inside each and every API. And when you build it, when you implement the API using MuleSoft Given Studio, so MuleSoft is providing an IDE called Anypoint Studio. So if I implement the API using this Anypoint Studio IDE, it has a plugin called API Kit plugin, which is capable of reading the YAML file, which you have designed in Design Center, and it is capable of generating all these things automatically inside the Mule application. Okay, so let us see it. So what I'm trying to say is, once you create the YAML file with some validations and all, and if you create a Mule application based on this YAML, inside the Mule application, the HTTP listeners, validations, exceptions, routing will be automatically created. So I'm just telling everything can be automatically created. I can say except business functionality, everything can be automatically created. So all we are left with is, you know, focusing on business functionality. And that business functionality also can be implemented with the help of just drag and drop. It's going to be ultimately easy for us. Okay. Let me quickly open that Anypoint Studio, which is IDE developed by MuleSoft, using which I can create Mule applications to use this MuleSoft VSB inside it, okay, to implement APIs. So I'm just using this Anypoint Studio. In the meantime, let me quickly create a workspace. See, this Anypoint Studio is nothing but Eclipse IDE plus some MuleSoft specific plugins. Just creating a new workspace, and you can see it says Eclipse launcher only. This studio is based on Eclipse IDE. So if you have worked on Eclipse IDE, so you feel the look and feel the look and feel will be same, and you will feel very familiar with that UI. Okay. Yeah, I can see the studio opened. And right now it is empty. Now I'm going to create a Mule application here. This studio comes with Mule server to deploy the Mule application once you build it. So I'm creating a Mule application. And while creating this Mule application, I can add my RAML file here. Let me just take a name for it. Customers API. And I'm adding the YAML file here. And this studio comes with a Mule server and with a specific version 3.9.1. You can download different version of studio for different Mule server, or you can just uninstall this Mule server, install different version of Mule server depending on the requirement. Now I need to select the YAML file. So plus, and I'm going to select the YAML file from Design Center. See, this is Design Center, isn't it? So whatever I'm in, this is the Design Center. You can see that, so you can see it. Okay. So from this Design Center, I'm going to import this YAML. So import from Design Center. Now I need to authenticate into my account because this Design Center is part of my account. I have to authenticate into my account to connect to this Design Center. Okay, so this is the API I want to import, customers API. Okay, and finish. Okay, it is downloading that YAML API. It is parsing it to understand what validations I have created there and how many operations I have created. You can see I have created /customers_get. Post 2 operations, then /customer_id get 3 operations. And finally, you can see the product is created. And coming to this Mule application, so this is XML based. So inside the Mule application, to implement any operation, if there are 3 operations in the YAML, I have to implement these 3 operations in the Mule application. To implement these operations, you need to create something called flows and all, but I am not really going to focus on what is the flow, the responsibilities and all. So this session is for explaining you how easily you can do the things in MuleCraft. So the requirement which I have taken is not hello world example, it's a real requirement which many companies are doing, customers API on top of database. And let me just explain you how easily and how fast you can do it. Okay, so I got some problem because of that examples attribute I'm using. You can clearly see it is complaining about examples. Let me just remove this example, change it to example. Then I'm good to go. Okay, now let me right click on it, Mule. Generate the flows from REST API, which is going to create the validations, the required flows. So flow is nothing but it is equivalent to a method in Java. So you can see this creating all predefined components for me. This creating the exception strategies here for various status codes for 400 405 415, and so on. And it is creating something called API Kit router, which can do the validations. It is creating HTTP listener. And it is creating API console here also, just like I have API console here. So when this project is deployed, the client can send requests to this API Kit console to understand what are the operations available. It's like, you know, if you develop a web service application, you can send requests to that web service application ?wsdl. So you can download the wsdl. In the same way, you can send requests to this flow here to see the YAML file visually. And the router will do the validations here, and then it will route the request to this below flows. And here you can see there is one flow created for each and every operation we have defined there. Okay, so this is for get customers, customer ID, and post customers. Okay, and inside the flows we have dummy functionality. I'm just deleting this dummy functionality, and in the place of that, I'm gonna create the real functionality. So my requirement is I want to fetch data from databases, right? So I just need to drag and drop a database connector, then double click on it, add the database configuration. It's going to be MySQL. So MySQL, I have a local MySQL database which I'm going to configure. You can see it here. And here I have a database called MuleDB, which has, I don't have customers table. Let me click create a customers table with customer ID. Name. Okay, the table name is t_customer. Okay, I don't have a primary key, okay, but that's fine. So t_ID. So ID int. Oh, the table is already there. Okay, I think it is. Just cancel. Yes. t_. Let me just refresh it. Okay, the table was not visible previously. Okay, let me just add some data. Customer ID 1, some name and the email ID. Okay, so we got some data. Now I'm going to connect to the database table, okay, using the port number 3306, which is the default one, the username, the password, database name. Okay, now I need to add a database jar file. Let me add a jar file. So I'm adding MySQL connector driver jar. Now I can test the connection. And this database connector is implicitly using JDBC for your information. Yeah. Now I need to select the database operation, which is going to be select query. Then I'm going to write the query on it. Select star from the table t_customers. Let's say we are getting that email. So where email, it's going to be a query parameter. So I don't want to hard code it. So I'm going to write a dynamic expression to retrieve the query parameter dynamically. So this is my query parameter name. Email is a query parameter name. So in the same way, I need to delete these components and write functionality. But anyway, we're not going to do it because of the time constraints. And from the database, as the database connector implicitly using JDBC, so from this database, I'm going to get the data in a Java object format. You can see the output section. It is list of Java map, but according to the YAML, the expected data is JSON array. So now we need to transform the data from list of map, which is coming from database, to JSON format. That I can do using this transform message component. Okay, Now in this transform message component, so it will automatically identify what is the expected output from the YAML file. It is automatically identifying the input coming from database from the database. Now all I'm gonna do is just drag and drop to map them. Now I can deploy the application. I can test it. Yeah, now this application is deployed. Now I can send request to this application using this HTTP listener configuration. So double click on this HTTP listener. This configuration, by default, this listener is listening at localhost 8081 port slash API slash star. So I'm gonna send a request to localhost 8081 slash API in the place of slash star. I have to send request to slash customers get method. So localhost 8081 slash customers get method. Localhost 8081 slash customers. And method name is get, and there I'm using a query parameter. Let me send that query parameter, email equal to AAA@gmail.com, and I should get the data corresponding to AAA. Okay, so sorry, so it's 8081 slash API slash star, right? So slash API slash customers, email equal to AAA@gmail.com, and I should get data for Jagdish. And if I just try with triple B, now this is not getting the data from YAML example. It is getting the real data from database using database connector. Okay. And if I use triple C, which is not even the part of the example, you can see the data for it. So, and if I just give the email like this, I'm getting a response, bad request. It's status code 400. So what is happening here? So now this slash API slash customers email equal to triple C will go to this listener. From the listener, it will go to API kit router, and the router will read the YAML file. According to the YAML, the email must contain at least 5 characters, at most 50 characters. But current email contains only 3 characters. Now if I give 2 more characters, yeah, it's gonna work, but I will get nothing, no data, as I don't have any email in my database with that name. So I don't have any data for that email address. So we don't get anything. So, okay guys, so this is how you can create mule applications, and this is about the API led architecture and AnyPoint platform, and how fast you can do the things in AnyPoint platform.